I know understanding fast-spoken French can be difficult, but with this lesson, you'll be rolling in laughter just like the audience. Salut! I'm Krithika from FluentU, and we want to help you learn French through real-world media so that you can speak just like a native.
Bonsoir, Québec! Wow! C'est la première fois de ma vie que je joue sur une scène à Québec. Première fois, c'est ce soir, c'est avec vous. Première fois, mais oui! J'ai joué au Québec, mes premières fois à Québec.
As Gad introduces himself here, he makes a distinction between au Québec and à Québec. But what exactly does this distinction entail? In French, you use different prepositions depending on what kind of place you're talking about. If you're talking about a city, you use à, like à Paris, à Montréal, à Lyon. But for larger places, like states, provinces, you use au for masculine places, like au Canada, and en for feminine places, like en France. In this section, Gad is making a distinction that he's performed in Quebec, the province, before, but he actually hasn't performed in Quebec City until this time. Unfortunately, there's little rhyme or reason to which places are masculine and feminine, so it's just something that you have to memorize.
Social, il y a des gens au premier rang, des gens au dernier rang, c'est comme ça, c'est la vie, hein, on n'y peut rien, là, oui. Mais ça veut rien dire, il y a des gens qui ont moins d'argent.
In this section, Gad is talking about people choosing to sit in different locations and is describing some differences between people, but he ends this passage with ça veut rien dire, which is a little confusing when you translate it directly, because it means that wants nothing to say. That doesn't really make much sense, but essentially he's saying that doesn't really mean much, or whatever he was saying doesn't really have much meaning.
Est-ce que vous aussi, par exemple, quand vous allez à la station service pour mettre de l'essence, vous voulez absolument arrondir le montant sur la pompe?
With comedy, it's really important to have a strong vocabulary, because even if you just miss one word, it's likely that the entire joke will be lost on you. Suddenly, you might find yourself watching a scene like this.
Brr, brr. 19, wow, 19, ta femme te parle, tu dis ta gueule chérie, je suis en finale, arrête.
And have no clue what's going on. Let's see how we got here.
Quand vous allez à la station service pour mettre de l'essence, vous voulez absolument arrondir le montant sur la pompe.
Gad speaks pretty fast here, but I did catch two words. Station service and pompe. When we look those up, we can see that Gad is talking about filling up gas. Now we have to fill in the rest of the words so that we learn some more vocabulary. So if we listen carefully, the first part of this phrase was quand vous allez à la station service pour mettre de l'essence. So let's say you didn't understand the words station service or pompe, you could use essence to kind of contextually put together what he's talking about in the story. Continuing this process, you would arrive at vous voulez absolument arrondir le montant sur la pompe. By the way, this tool that I'm using right now is called FluentU, a platform that turns real-world videos like movie clips and TV shows into engaging language lessons. It's got all the tools you're missing when you're trying to learn language on your own, like a video dictionary, flashcards, and quizzes, and it's the closest thing you can have to having a real native speaker with you while you're learning. There's a link to a free trial in the description, so check it out for yourself and start sounding vraiment français.
L'autre jour, je suis dans l'avion pour arriver à Montréal, il y a un mec assis à côté de moi, il se mouche et après il regarde. Pourquoi? Pourquoi il regarde? Pourquoi il analyse? S'il y en a trop, il va en remettre. Comment ça se passe?
In this clip, judging by his hand gestures, we can see that il se mouche means either to sneeze or to wipe one's nose. And if you know that un mouchoir is a tissue, then you can figure out that se moucher means to blow one's nose.
Pourquoi il regarde? Pourquoi il analyse? S'il y en a trop, il va en remettre. Comment ça se passe?
Although Gad is very animated in this section, you might notice that his voice actually stays at a very steady pitch. This is one thing that tends to trip up a lot of French learners, especially if they come from speaking English, because French really doesn't rely on voice inflection to change the meanings of sentences. With French, you're better off listening to your gut and listening for the meanings of words, because the voice inflection is really not going to help you decipher a sentence. However, we can use some tricks. You might notice that each phrase in the sentence begins with a question word. Pourquoi il regarde? Pourquoi il analyse? Si il y en a trop, il va remettre? Comment ça se passe? So even if his voice doesn't rise at the end like a question, we still know that these phrases are questions because they begin with question words. Taking a closer look at the phrase si il y en a trop, il va remettre, we can see that French people often omit saying il y a and just choose to say il y a. The function of en in this sentence is to describe what goes in the tissue, because en is used to describe things that are in specific. So, si y en a trop means if there's too much in the tissue. I know, gross. If you're talking about something specific, you would use le or la. And if you're talking about something general, you would use on. Par exemple, j'ai acheté une pomme hier, je la mange maintenant. The important thing with on is that it has to be followed by a quantity specifier. So it could be a number, like deux or trois, like je vais acheter des gâteaux, j'en veux deux. Or it can be more general, like un peu, beaucoup, or in Gad's case, trop.
That's a lot of information to get in 30 seconds.
On était dans une soirée peinard, tranquille, calme, soirée sans obstacle, ok? Sans obstacle. Au Québec, on dit pas la fin des mots, hein. C'est un de ces trucs qui existent. En tant qu'humoriste, on dit obstacle. Alors.
Here, Gad is pulling some fun at l'accent québécois. So he says, on dit pas les fins de mots. So humoriste becomes humoriste, and obstacle becomes obstacle. This is a great useful clue if you are watching any Québécois media. If you find yourself confused about words that you're hearing, try using Gad's tip and try to imagine what is the sound or phrase that could be coming at the end of words that they might be omitting.
C'est comme ça. Au Québec, je sais pas pourquoi. Hein, ils ont enlevé les TRE à la fin de tous les mots.
Let's keep going.
Et là, ma femme me regarde et elle me fait les fameuses questions pièges. Je m'adresse à vous, messieurs. On connaît tous ça. Chérie, est-ce que tu m'aimerais toujours? Si, tu dis, putain, qu'est-ce qui va se passer après ceci?
Now, if you watched our previous video on French words with multiple meanings, you would know that si has many different meanings depending on context. While in some cases it can mean yes, in this case, si means something else. Since Gad started this phrase with a question word, est-ce que, we know that si can't mean yes, and it also can't mean so. So in this case, si means if.
Si je pesais 350 livres en plus. Non.
Okay, so she says, si je pesais 350 livres en plus, and suddenly Gad is astonished and he says, ben non.
Non.
The two culprits in this phrase could be peser and livre, but peser has so many different meanings based on context, it might not be so helpful. Let's try replacing peser with some commonly used verbs that are associated with livre. Is she saying, est-ce que tu m'aimerais si j'écrivais 350 livres en plus? Or perhaps, si je lirais 350 livres en plus? Neither of these really explain why Gad is so exclamatory. Okay, let's try looking up the definition of livre. If we look up livre, we can see that, oh, livre also means pounds. So his wife is asking si elle est beaucoup plus grande si Gad l'aimerait. Ouch, Gad.
Non. Je t'aime, mais y a des limites. Oh.
Real media like this is a great way to see how difficult grammar tenses are applied in real life.
On n'est pas pareil. La manière de dormir aussi, on n'est pas pareil. Nous les hommes, soit on dort pas. C'est binaire, c'est A ou B. Les femmes, c'est des trucs que je comprends pas.
Here, Gad uses le subjonctif to say soit on dort, soit on dort pas. Le subjonctif is quite a difficult grammar tense, which is used to describe things that are unsure, possibilities, or something that you're thinking or is a wish or a desire. In this case, it's appropriate to use le subjonctif because Gad is describing something that's hypothetical. Men either sleep or they don't sleep.
En fait, j'ai pas vraiment dormi, j'étais en train de m'endormir au moment où tu m'as réveillé, je croyais que je dormais, mais en fait, je dormais pas du tout, ça m'a fait faire une sieste juste avant, et en fait, je me suis réveillé au milieu, j'avais l'impression que je dormais, en fait, j'étais réveillé, c'est ça qui est fou, donc dorénavant, je vais faire une petite sieste avant de me coucher.
Wow, that section was vraiment fou. So, if you didn't catch everything that Gad said, how do you go about understanding a section like that? One thing that trips up French learners a lot is trying to figure out the conjugations of verbs. You might notice yourself trying to decipher which verb tense each word is, and you might find yourself zoning out instead of listening to the entire passage. Instead, grab a sheet of paper and try to just write down the infinitive of every verb that you hear, and space them out a little bit so you have space in between to write down more words. Then, go back and write down any adjectives, nouns, or transition words that you hear. Anything significant. Finally, make another pass through and try to write down the subjects and the conjugations and verb tenses so that you can fully put together the passage. Remember, you can always slow down a YouTube video if you need help.
Et cette capacité qu'elles ont, mesdames, de dormir et en même temps être au courant de tout ce qui se passe dans la maison, comment vous faites? Nous on dort, il peut y avoir un tremblement de terre.
The final tip I'll give you to understanding French videos on YouTube is to remember that auto-generated closed captioning still exists, at least for now. I encourage you not to use this tip too much because you should get used to listening to native French speakers and training your ear to hear those words, but it's a good starting point if you're completely lost in a section. For example, if you didn't understand this section, you could turn on closed captioning and try to find the word that you didn't understand. So it says tremblement de terre. You can then look it up on a platform such as FluentU to see if the translation makes sense. In this case, Yad is talking about men sleeping through loud noises, so an earthquake, which is a loud rumbling noise, makes sense in this context. You can even listen to it to make sure it sounds exactly like what you heard on YouTube.
Tremblement de terre.
Nous on dort, il peut y avoir un tremblement de terre. Vous avez un sommeil en Bluetooth.
Be sure to apply these tips when you watch the rest of Gad Elmaleh's show or perhaps any other French media so that you can build your fluency. And if you want more tips to speak French just like a natural, be sure to check out our previous video on French phrases that you can use to sound like a native.